this video, we'll talk about the extra embryonic membrane, how they are formed and their functions. These extra embryonic membranes, they are four. Let us write down their names: amnion, chorion, yolk sac, and allantois. These are the four extra embryonic membranes, and they develop from trophoblast or trophoectoderm. So trophoblast is the layer which gives rise to these extra embryonic membranes. One more important thing, these extra embryonic membranes are found in the eggs of amniotes. And these amniotes group, it includes reptiles, birds, and the egg, or even mammals, complete mammals. So there are three groups which are considered as the amniotes. In these eggs or in these embryos, there are four extra embryonic membranes. These membranes, they perform different functions, and in case of this, the embryo actually develops in the watery medium. So we'll see the structure. Now, to understand what these membranes are, let us draw. Say this is the embryo part. This is the embryo. And now, if you're able to recall, when we were talking about gastrulation, we said the first germ layer which develops is endoderm. The upper part of endoderm, which was towards the embryonal knob, that gives rise to the gut part. And the lower part of the endoderm, which was along with trophoderm, that gives rise to yolk sac and allantois. So from here, we find a sac-like, a bag-like structure. This is called the yolk sac. And as the name tells us, yolk sac would store yolk. It is highly reduced in case of humans. We'll write down their functions also. The next sac-like or bag-like structure, which is slightly on the anterior side, this is called the allantois. This is allantois. And the complete embryo is inside one more layer. So this is the part which is covering the complete embryo. This membrane is called the amnion. And this entire structure is enclosed inside the chorion. So this outer membrane, which is going to cover yolk sac, allantois, and here are these chorionic villi. So this outermost layer is the chorion. Now, these layers, they have one of the germ layer and a lining of the other germ layer. Let us see this part first. In yolk sac, outside this, there is mesodermal lining. So, we call such a membrane as splanchnopleure. It is called splanchnopleure. What happens in splanchnopleure is inner is endoderm and outer is mesoderm. So here there are two layers which are making the wall of this yolk sac. Inner is endoderm, the one which we have drawn in red, and this is the same endoderm which was drawing that, or which was lining the trophoblast. And from outside it gets lined with mesoderm. Same is the case with allantois. This is endoderm and outside it is mesoderm. That means the wall is again splanchnopleure. So here also it is splanchnopleure. Splanchnopleure is again going to mean the same thing. Inner is endoderm and outer layer is mesoderm. These are two layers that we have talked of. One of yolk sac, another of allantois. Now let us come to amnion. This part, it develops from ectoderm and it gets lined with mesoderm. So now when you look at this sac, it has inner ectoderm and outer mesoderm. Such a layer is known as somatopleure. In somatopleure, inner is ectoderm and outer is mesoderm. So such a layer is somatopleure. Let us come to this chorion. Chorion has this layer which is made up of ectoderm and it is lined with mesoderm. So now when we put this layer, it is also somatopleure because it also has two layers, ecto and mesoderm. But in this case, outer is ecto and inner is mesoderm. That means somatopleure and splenculopleure terms are given on the basis of which two layers are making the wall. If it is endomeso, we call it splenculopleure. If it is ecto and meso, we call it somatopleure. So out of four extraamnionic membrane, the walls of two are somatopleure and two are splenculopleure. Yolk sac and allantois, they are splenculopleure, and chorion and amnion, they are somatopleure. Now let us come to the functions which are performed by these four extraembryonic membranes. Yolk sac, it stores the food in the form of yolk. It digests, absorbs it, and then passes it on to the embryo. And that is why it is known as extraembryonic gut. It behaves like extraembryonic gut. Our digestive system or our alimentary canal also does the same thing. It absorbs the nourishment and then this nourishment is taken to various tissues. So here also the yolk will be digested, absorbed, and that will be passed on to the embryo. But in this case here we will write down that in case of humans it is very poorly developed because the nourishment which is being supplied to the embryo is coming through the placenta from the maternal tissue. So this is non-functional, but it is very well developed in case of birds and reptiles. Because birds and reptiles, when they lay eggs, after that there is no connection between the maternal tissue. So, the egg should have sufficient nutritive material to fulfill the complete requirement of the embryonic development. Such eggs are known as cladoic eggs. So, this egg, that is the reptilian and bird egg, is known as cladoic egg, which basically means self-sufficient. There is enough nourishment which is more than enough for the complete embryonic development. So this is about yolk sac. In humans it is very very reduced, whereas in birds and reptiles it is very well developed. Now let us come to allantois. Allantois stores all the waste material, the nitrogenous waste. So it acts as extra embryonic kidney. It stores or it removes the waste from the embryo. Removes waste. Again, it is poorly developed in case of humans. So, this was about yolk sac. Now, if we are talking about allantois, again, poorly developed in humans. Reason is the same. Because placenta is the structure which is going to remove all the waste from the fetus. So, as placenta is supplying the nourishment, it is also removing the waste material. So, these two are very poorly developed in case of human beings. Now, let us come to amnion. Before that, in this cavity, which is known as the amniotic cavity, is a fluid. This fluid is secreted by amnion as well as the fetus. This is called amniotic fluid. And this fluid, it provides aqueous medium for the development of the embryo. Plus, there are some cells here. And these cells, they are called fetal cells. They have detached from the fetal body when the fetus was being formed. During amniocentesis, it's a technique by which certain deformities, certain defects can be detected. So these cells are taken out, microliter of this fluid is taken out, the cells are cultured, and then the cells are studied to find out whether there is some kind of deformity or not. That technique is known as amniocentesis. So this is the amniotic fluid. Function, this amniotic fluid, it acts as a shock absorber. Plus, it is providing the aquatic medium for the development of the embryo. Now comes the last layer, that is chorion. It helps in, again, gaseous exchange. So, this chorion, here I'm writing for chorion, it acts as extra embryonic lung. Because in our case, the lungs are the structures which are helping in gaseous exchange. But these are the layers which are outside the embryo. And they are formed from trophoderm or trophoectoderm. Their function is only to support or help various processes. But in case of humans, as there is placenta through which food will be transferred, waste will be removed. So these two extra embryonic membranes are not that developed. Amnion is very well developed. Amniotic fluid is there. So the embryo is actually dipped in water, a watery environment. And chorion. Chorion is the layer which participates in placenta formation. We have seen types of placenta. Whether it is yolk sac placenta, then in that case, this wall, that is yolk sac wall, and chorion will form the placenta. Then we call it yolk sac placenta. We also talked about allantoic placenta, where this allantois and chorion would participate. And third, which is found in humans, is only chorionic. We also said that this amnion, it does not participate in placenta formation. So these four layers are extra embryonic membranes, and they have or they perform some special functions. They are outside the embryo, and that's why we call them extra embryonic